to acknowledge, and they took Sheldon's apology. Of course, to tell you frankly, this is an unexpected situation, so the college was not prepared for that. Nevertheless, the college tried to give it best by providing some of the boys, although they asked them to bring their accommodation and their bedding mattress, they couldn't bring because they were full of fear. They thought that by carrying their things, some people may come and attack them. So in that way, whatever that the hostel has, we took from there and we provided whatever we could. Then the boys, they really enjoyed, the boys and the girls. There were 7 girls and the rest were all the boys. So boys were more in that number. And what we did during their stay, most of them they stayed for 3 days. Yeah, most of them they stayed for 4 or 5 days. What we did was usually in the evening, we had all gifts together as a group. Then around 7 o'clock, we all came together as a group. Then we had party games. Then we all get together, singing, dancing, and just to make us feel at home. Then at the end of all these activities, we just ended with short prayer. Praying for peace and harmony in our society. And after that, it was followed by some just very delicious meals provided by some generous persons. So all these are the different activities that we're doing. The students, they felt very secure because by hearing that the college is providing security, they felt very safe. And there were some policemen who were sent specially for this reason. So that way, they felt very secure to be here. And to end my talk, I would like to just say that we also thank especially some media persons who came to help us to raise our voices. Because of their presence, our voices, our struggle were heard from different places. So thank you one and all.
Thank you very much, Joseph. Before I invite the first speaker, Mr. Ghosh, just a quick note on why we selected this particular topic and why we have said what role can media play in the time of SMS and Facebook. It's fairly obvious. I mean, you have seen the power of the SMS spread and the kind of fan out it can have. It's instantaneous technology. Both good news and bad news can spread pretty fast. It seems like bad news will spread faster. There's also Facebook, which is instantaneous again. We felt amongst the media professionals that these are people-to-people communication tools that work even separately from the media, to the point that they can let people talk to each other without the media at all. So what role would the media play, you know, maybe to prevent this exodus, maybe to dispel the rumors, is there a role at all? That's partly what resulted in this particular framing of the question that you see. So let me invite Mr. Ghosh for his presentation.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. What I am going to talk about is the riots, the exodus, and the missing, if there is one. You see, the subject at hand is extremely complex. So I'll need to jump the gun and I'll need to rush through, not only because Subbu is going to be down my neck. I'm going to share some experiences, some observations with you, but some passing remarks first. One of the reasons why people here in India do men in India fail to understand what's been happening in the Northeast is because we like to hear what we believe. We disregard things that do not conform to our narrative about the Northeast. We have fixed notions about the Northeast. I'm not talking about stereotyping here. I'm talking about something more complicated, more complex than that. Now, I will be pursuing academics with a journalistic approach. I'm one of those old fashioned journalists who still believe that journalism at the end of the day needs to be about the people. And there's a reason why I'm saying this. In my 20 years of producing books on the Northeast, on travel, traveling in the Northeast, I have realized that the discourse in mainland India kind of always leaves out the people of the Northeast. Now, I should also be presenting a very, very contrarian view that would kind of border on the political, and that would probably result in me not making too many friends out here this evening. Let's see. The story so far. See, what we are dealing with here is a multidimensional problem, and a multidimensional problem always needs a multidimensional approach if you have a solution in mind. Now, this solution, if you talk about violence, is not an answer, and neither is pseudo-secularism. The disinformation and the misinformation campaigns that have been running in the media, both the mainstream media as well as the alternative media, have just been too much. I will elaborate on that slightly later. You see, both Indian civil society, the alternative media, have been pretty guilty. They have been as guilty as political parties and the mainstream media in their misrepresentation of facts and flagrant criminalization of the entire issue. Both the exodus that happened from Bangalore and a couple of other cities, as well as the borderland riots that took place in the last week of July and in the first week of August. Now, I have a point to make here. You see, the point is always about asking the right questions. If you don't ask the right questions, you don't get the right answers. And if you don't get the right answers, you kind of grope in the dark and you talk rubbish. Now, why is it that the real story has not been told about the Northeast? It's primarily because nobody wants to know the truth. People suffer from an ostrich syndrome. That's what I kind of alluded to earlier, that we like to hear about the Northeast only insofar as what we want to believe, nothing else. Now, let's start with the exodus itself. I'll start with the exodus and not the riots, because we are here in Bangalore. It would make sense if we talk about the exodus first. Now, there are lots of myths, there are lots of lies, and there are lots of unanswered questions. The first thing would be about the SMS issue. There was the SMS issue given too much of importance. There were these three young people who gave their experiences. I really wouldn't want to go into the SMS issue here right now. But there are other things as well. Were there attacks on Northeasterners at all? The media and civil society, left liberals, would want us to believe that there were not. As far as I know, there were. There were about some 20 or something between 20 and 30 attacks on Northeasterners here in Bangalore. Now, take into account the fact that there are about 2.5 lakh people from the Northeast living here in Bangalore. 20 to 30 is a very small number. I mean, it's not possible that you would know everyone, and it is also quite possible that if somebody is indeed attacked, you will never come to know about it, unless of course you know the person himself or herself. There were attacks, and these were censored at different stages. These were censored at the police station level. These were also censored at the media level. And did the social media have a role to play? No. We Indians also suffer from something that the Americans suffer from. We're trying to look for an enemy where none probably exists. If you look at those James Bond films, you know how the a perceived an image of the West have been changing over the years. There's something like that here in India. We are looking for an enemy, and these social media people are setting that sort of thing. If you don't have anyone to blame, you can always blame the social media. Now, right from Kapil Sibal onwards to everyone else. Now coming to the point itself, did the social media have a role to play? I personally think no. Not in the case of the extremists, definitely not. The extremists started sometime around 4 noon on the 15th of August. I am connected to Twitter, Facebook like 24 hours a day. I didn't say anything. There were no trending topics. The extremists was not there in the social media the first day. It wasn't there even on the second day. Only after there were reports appeared in the papers that there were a few tweets here and there, very sporadic tweets sometime in the forenoon again and later in the day. My point here is that social media did not trigger the exodus, plain and simple. It did not. I'll come to the next media now. These are quite an errant lot, you know. The mainstream media, we always like to blame the mainstream media. I should make a disclosure here. I work with the mainstream media now. That's after a hiatus of about 14 years. Anyway, coming back to the mainstream media. Did the mainstream media behave yourself? I think they overbehave themselves probably. That's because when everything was kind of toned down, everything was kind of sincere to an extent. Of course, that's how you probably behave if you want to be responsible. But of course, that would be a different canvas altogether. Now, how much of self-censorship should you do? By and large, I think the mainstream media behaves itself differently than the extremists. Definitely, yes. I mean, if I talk about the mainstream media, I would probably be talking more of the English language media. Probably the English would be able to throw more light on the role of the kind of media. Now, did the non-English media add to the problem? No, not at all. Did you see the SNS newspapers the first 3 days? I'm sure you did. First 3 days, there was stunned silence in a sand. People did not react. People reacted only after the second day, or mainly after the third day. The non-English media did not contribute to the exodus at all. There was a class debate. Nobody seemed to have noticed. Why is it that most of the people seem to be leaving by train rather than by flights? I was at that point of time planning a trip to the Northeast, and I know for certain that flights were not really chock-a-block. There are people fleeing Bangalore in trains. I think there is probably a little bit of a class divide. Nobody seemed to have noticed that, including our leftist friends who talk about class divides all the time, even they didn't notice it. Now, the SMS ban on the blocking of non-Christians. Probably Lawrence will talk about this, hopefully. I'll just talk about blocking of the non-Christian sites. Not non-Christian sites, there's a huge group on Facebook called Stop Discriminating People from the Northeast. It's run by a very young friend of mine, his name is John Hinto. He's a Maran Naga from Manipur. That is not an inflammatory group at all. I see someone in Northeastern kids here. I'm sure many of you would probably be part of the group. That group is not inflammatory. It's not racist at all. It is anti-racist. It's an anti-racist group. Why is it that such a group was formed? These are questions probably Rahul Rans would have an answer to. The riots. I need to go to the riots now. All for good reason. The problem with the riots is not the riots, actually. It's about the criminalization of the riots. In the media, in public discourse, among civil society members, among left liberals. You need to understand something about the riots. Riots in India and clashes in the Northeast are not the same things.